Britain is an island, surrounded by a cold and unforgiving sea. For centuries, it protected us from attack. But to prosper and thrive, we would need to do more than just hide behind her saltwater shield. Britain needed brave men, willing to venture out into the unknown, and she needed good boats to take them there. I've spent my life at sea. Now I'm going to take passage on six boats that together tell the story of modern Britain. Built for exploration, war, fishing, industry, and our very survival. These are the boats that built Britain and changed the way we live forever. Now, I'm sailing on the Matthew, the ship that discovered North America and launched Britain on a maritime adventure the like of which the world had never seen.
I've come to Bristol to see this remarkable boat. Over 500 years ago, 18 men crammed in here with explorer and mapmaker John Cabot to set sail on a voyage that many of the onlookers must have thought was suicidal.
The year was 1497. Only 5 years earlier, Columbus had discovered the islands of the Caribbean, but his friend John Cabot was convinced he could find an alternative route to the east and make a fortune of his own. Instead, Cabot discovered North America and changed the course of British and world history forever. This is an exact replica of the Matthew, the craft he chose for their seemingly impossible mission. A common cargo ship, she was more used to coastal trading than crossing oceans. Only 78 feet long, she feels a tiny vessel for such a momentous journey into the unknown. But what she lacked in space and sophistication, she more than made up for in strength and reliability. And in 1497, she was the best boat for the job. So crowded in and with no real idea of where they were going or how long they'd be at sea, Cabot and his crew of 18 men pushed off into the abyss. I want to know more about this boat that changed the world and sailor for myself.
In particular, I want to see the world as a 15th century sailor would have understood it. I want to get inside their heads and find out exactly what they thought they were doing.
And what it must have been like to sail beyond the limits of the known world in this tiny little ship. But to understand the Matthew and her voyage, we need to go back another 200 years to when Marco Polo made a momentous overland trip into Asia. His book, The Marvels of the World, talks of roofs tiled with gold, chests filled with pearls and spices by the sackload. As Europe emerged from the uncertainties of the medieval period, curiosity about the world grew, and John Cabot was given a copy of the book by none other than the explorer Christopher Columbus. And Polo's tales of Eastern riches convinced him that he too could make his fortune and secure a name for himself. But the problem was getting there. Hardline Ottomans controlled the trade routes, and for a Christian explorer, a journey over land was more likely to end in a nasty death than untold riches. If Cabot was to make his fortune, he needed to find another way, across the sea. In the 15th century, understanding of the world's oceans was extremely limited. And mapmaking was the preserve of the monasteries. The resulting worldview, more superstition than science, can be seen in all its glorious confusion here at Hereford Cathedral on the famous Mappa Mundi. The map bears almost no relationship to the round world we now know, but is based on myths and legend. Drawn up by monks, it only shows how they imagined distant lands, with no proper understanding of where they really were. And for many people, the belief was that beyond the edge of a map like this lay untold horrors. But I, for one, believe that medieval seamen had a much more sophisticated sense of the shape of our world.
As children, we were all shown images of medieval seamen sailing over the edge of a flat earth and plunging down to destruction with expressions of despair. Well, you know, from the medieval seamen's point of view, that was a load of absolute tosh. They never thought that at all. You see, they knew the world was round. When you see a ship coming up over the horizon, the first thing you see are the top sails. And as she comes closer, the hull comes up. First, she's hull down, then she's hull up. That's the old phrase, and it's nothing to do with her being too far away to sea. It's to do with her coming up over the edge of the world. They knew that full well. They also knew when they looked at the horizon, they could see a tiny little bit of curvature on it. It all stacked up.
For explorers to succeed, they needed maps based on sound science that backed up the observations of sailormen. And towards the end of the 15th century, just such maps were appearing. Hungry for knowledge, scholars were scouring library shelves and discovering that the Greeks and Romans had known a lot more about the world than they did. But for explorers, one work stood out. Ptolemy, the great Roman mathematician, had already mapped much of Europe and Asia. And when his maps were printed for the first time in 1477, they caused a sensation. The maps showed the extent of the known world, a world that started in Spain and ended in China. For anyone wanting to find a short cut to the riches of the East, the maps offered a tantalizing idea, an idea that would change the world forever.
Here's a flat world map. If you're going to put it on a piece of paper, it's the only way you can do it, really. But if you're a sailor and a world traveler, or perhaps a scholar who understands that the world's round, all you got to do is that, and suddenly you can go the other way. There's another route altogether, and it goes across this unknown ocean, which as yet nobody has mapped or even sailed across.
The idea was brilliantly simple. If Cabot was right, he'd have found a shortcut to the treasures of the East. But it was a huge gamble, and to prove his point, he'd need to find a wealthy backer willing to pay for the boat and men required for the voyage. So Cabot arrived here in Bristol to try and bring his plan to life. And I've come here to meet Dr. Evan Jones, who has spent years studying Cabot's voyage. I want to ask him more about the man behind this historic journey.
Well, Cabot's proper name, Juan Caboto, was a Venetian merchant, but by 1489, he'd got into trouble, and he left Venice as an insolvent debtor, then to be pursued by his creditors in Spain. He goes to Valencia, and he first of all proposes he's going to build a new harbour there. But he doesn't get funding for that, so he moves on, with his creditors just behind him, moves on to Seville. And there he proposes the building of a bridge over the Guadalquivir. But the whole thing falls through. And it seems to be only after that, around about 1494, 1495, he starts getting this new idea. But what he's going to do is lead an expedition across the Atlantic. So first of all, he tries to persuade people in Seville to fund him. Doesn't get any joy. He moves on to Lisbon, tries to persuade the Portuguese to fund him. Again, no success. It's only after that, in 1495, that he comes to London and tries to get backing there from Henry VII and his court.
Turned down all over Europe, Cabot had finally found a willing patron in Henry VII, a monarch desperate to play colonial catch-up with Spain and Portugal. He immediately issued Cabot with a charter, giving him the power to claim whatever land he found as British.
to find, discover, and investigate whatsoever islands, countries, regions, or provinces of heathens and infidels in whatsoever part of the world placed, which before this time were unknown to all Christians. Well, that's pretty non-PC these days. What's it mean?
Well, it means that wherever Cabot went with his ship, as long as the territories hadn't been found by Christians, which in practice meant the Spanish or the Portuguese, you know, anything which is non-Christian, that's fair game. These are heathens. You can do what you want.
Cabot had his theory. He had a royal backer. What he needed now was a boat.
When Cabot walked the Bristol waterfront with the King's charter in one hand and the King's shilling in the other, he was looking for a ship. A ship capable of a voyage of indeterminate length through some of the roughest seas in the known world. When he saw the Matthew, he knew he'd found her.
As an Italian, Cabot would have recognised the Matthew's lines immediately. She was a caravelle, a type of cargo ship popular in southern Europe and Portugal. But as well as carrying cargo, the caravelle was also starting to make a name for herself in the world of exploration. Two of the three boats Columbus sailed to the Caribbean 5 years earlier were caravelles. And by the standards of the 15th century, they were considered excellent sailing vessels. Tough, versatile, and seaworthy. But judged by today's thinking, the Matthew leaves a lot to be desired.
Looking around with a seaman's eye, I can see that this vessel has serious limitations. For a start, she's not going to be able to sail properly to windward in our terms. That means she'll go across the wind either way and downwind. And if the wind's coming from where you want to go, tough luck, mate. You'll have to wait.
And for her crew, 18 men assembled from the dockside, a ragtag mixture of able seamen, fortune hunters, a priest and a cook, it was going to be an uncomfortable ride. Because she's built like a barrel, with a gently rounded hull designed to take the ground in rivers and harbours. At sea, though, that means she'll roll from side to side, a sickly motion in any sort of a swell.
But she gives a feeling of being strong and reliable. Even the rig feels pretty bulletproof, actually. And for the guys going off across the Western Ocean, that was probably the most important single thing.
When the crew stepped onto this boat, they may not all have been convinced by Cabot's theories, but the boat certainly looked up to the job.